So last time we saw that the interest rate should be fed not only the interest rates offered by competing federations like the United States, but also compensate for any loss of purchasing power due to the devaluation of the tenge. So it's a lot like the fiscal inflation, you remember, that the interest rate, the nominal interest rate reflects the real interest rate plus a term that adjusts for inflation. In this case, for the parity condition, it is exactly the same idea, except now we are talking about foreign purchasing power. With the fiscal inflation, we are talking about a domestic purchasing power. So it looks something like this. In the Fisher equation, the market interest rate, that is the nominal interest rate, expressed in tenge, equals the real interest rate plus the expected rate of inflation. So you remember that equation. This interest rate adjusts for changes in domestic purchasing power. That is, it adjusts for changes in domestic prices. So, for example, in Kazakhstan, the rate of inflation is about 7%. That is, the interest rate will compensate the lender for the fact that inflation is damaging the value of the tenge in purchasing goods here in Kazakhstan. So it is almost exactly the same idea for the parity condition. Now, the interest rate, either nominal or real, doesn't matter. In Kazakhstan, must at least equal the interest rate in the United States. Otherwise, people will not buy our bonds or assets. Plus the expected rate of depreciation in the tenge. By decline, I mean in real terms, what the tenge can actually purchase in terms of dollar values. So this interest rate adjusts for not domestic purchasing power, but instead foreign purchasing power. How many dollars can this interest rate purchase? and the exchange rate obtained for velvet. So here's an example. In Kazakhstan, the nominal exchange rate paid for velvet has increased by roughly 4% over the past year. That is, the taking velvet value has fallen by 4%. So somebody who is holding taking for his vault will want to be compensated for that continued loss of foreign purchasing power. And otherwise, if he trades his tingi for dollars, but by exports from the United States, he is going to find himself on the short end of the stick. He demands an interest rate that is 4% higher in order to recoup the fall in dollar purchasing power. What's this for? So the terms and conditions is really a very simple idea, just like the fishing equation. Okay, here's a puzzle for you to try now for 1 point of extra credit. We have an interest rate in the United States of 5%. And we expect next year that the exchange rate will be 500 penny per dollar. At one point, we thought that this was impossible, but it's not. And suppose that the current exchange rate is 400 penny per dollar. Then can you take a moment to calculate the interest rate in Kazakhstan that the terms condition will now predict? So please take a couple of minutes to make the simple calculation, and then we will discuss it as a class. 2 minutes. So what have you found out? For a point of extra credit, what is the interest rate now predicted for Kazakhstan? Well, let's see, our interest rate must be competitive with that of the United States, 5%. And we must also compensate for the loss of dollar value in the tenge. So we need the exchange rate expected next year, 2022, minus the exchange rate that is known now, this year. And then express all of that is a relative rate of change in the exchange rate of tenge to dollar. So let's substitute in our data. We think that the exchange rate will be 500 tenge next year. Today it is 400 tenge, actually even higher than that. So what is the expected rate of change in the exchange rate of tenge per dollar? So 100 divided by the base of 400. So that the interest rate in Kazakhstan is 5% plus 55%. For the depreciation or an interest rate in Kazakhstan of a whopping 30% just remain competitive with the United States in attracting financial investors. Sounds outlandish, but remember 2015, when the tenge crashed, we were facing this kind of predicament. Banks were not able to provide assets that would pay as much as 30% interest, the 30% interest rate. Okay, questions about the currency condition. Here is another puzzle for a point of extra credit to consider. I will give you a moment to read through this slide. So in this case, the initial interest rate is 5%. And it's even today, 5% in the United States. And we observe that the exchange rate of penny to a dollar is rising about 7% per year. Finally, the actual interest rate in Kazakhstan is 15%. So the question for you is this. Given these data, should we buy US bonds or Kazakhstani bonds? And why? But you move. A couple of minutes to discuss the problem among yourselves, and then we will put that together and consider it as a class. So what do you think? Would you rather have bonds from Kazakhstan or from the United States? What do you think? So let's see. The interest parity condition up to this, and it's a state in Kazakhstan. Of how much? Of 12%. So in other words, if the bond is paying interest of 12%, over the 20 years, there's just barely enough money to compensate for depreciation of the taking. But in reality, the interest rate in Kazakhstan is not just 12%, but 15% instead. To make the problem simple, let's assume that the inflation rate is the same in both countries. And that there is no special risk to holding bonds expressed in trading. So now, given those assumptions, what do you do? Would you put a ban from Pakistan or from the United States? Well, of course, for what? Who would put a ban here in Pakistan? Because it's purchasing power is actually increasing. We get a boost in purchasing power of 3%. So when we collect our interest payment in tenge next year, and convert the tenge to dollars, we will realize a windfall in purchasing power in dollar terms of 3%. So this, for once, buy the Kazakhstan bond rather than the bond from Uncle Sam. Finally, you may ask, why does anybody really care about interest parity? Well, here's the problem today. I'll give you a moment to read through this slide. So you can see that it is a fairly safe bet that the interest rate in Kazakhstan is going to rise rather substantially. Probably the next year, the interest rate in the US will be about 2%. To that, add the adjustment of 4%, and now Kazakhstan is facing an interest rate of 6% even after adjusting for inflation. So, what, if anything, is wrong with that? Why would we worry about a high interest rate next year? Well, first, if Kazakhstan, for some reason, is not able to increase its interest rates that much, many will flow up over the borders into other countries, but China, Russia, and the United States. Also, higher interest rates will be expensive for the government of Kazakhstan that has been running a deficit now for several years. So you remember that the public deficit is just the amount of spending by the government. Minus tax revenues. And then the public debt. It's the total amount owed to the government, to its creditors. So although the deficit just needs to, this has happened this year, the public debt adds together all of the deficits of past years, since they have not yet fully offset with our payments. So it's a little bit of the balance on your credit card. All right, so now interest rates are rising sharply. So interest payments are rising on the public debt. So the government received a rise in its total debt. Because now it owes more in interest payments than it had last year. In addition, if the government is going to run another deficit, it will have to borrow money to paper over the difference between spending and tax revenues. So the higher interest rate may increase the public deficit. Is anything else, any other reason why we might worry about a much higher interest rate in the future than we are fishing today? So let's see, although higher interest rates attract private investment, for example, in education. Now it is more expensive to borrow money from the bank to pay for tuition. Your student loan becomes more expensive. So what we do, one possibility is that you may postpone your education until you can afford the tuition. So there is one problem. The higher interest rates may cause human capital to decrease. And then, certainly, the same prediction holds for any other asset. So a general stock of capital, including physical capital and human capital, will slow down. Just the capital stock does not grow so rapidly now. Economic growth of GDP in Kazakhstan will also slow down. So there is one more possible implication of the likely increase in interest rates next year. Okay, so far. So are you comfortable with the difference between the deficit and the debt? Also, are you comfortable with the idea that higher interest rates may slow down investment and therefore also slow down the economy? Can you see that slide? It says hold banks manage interest rate risk. Can you see that slide? I will assume that you can, but if not, let me know or send me a note by chat. Here is a graph of the net worth of provincial banks in Kazakhstan. Since early 2020. What do you conclude about the trend in net worth? So you can see that it is rising steadily, more rapidly than the rate of inflation. So there is a real gain in net worth and profitability of our banks. Presumably, much of this is due to the fact that we are catching up since the lockdowns of last year. But beyond that, there could be other reasons why our banks are becoming more profitable. So let's take a look at the impact of the interest rate on the profits of a provincial bank. One approach that we may take is to compute the net assets that we have that are sensitive to the interest rate, and then determine how a higher interest rate may affect the net assets that respond to the interest rate. So I will call the difference between rate sensitive liabilities and assets just the gap. Don't fall into the gap. Here's an example from the last National Bank. Here's a T-sheet of assets and liabilities. So, for example, we might have a loan liabilities that are sensitive to the interest rate CDs, certificates of deposit. And then assets that are sensitive to the interest rate may include variable rate mortgages. For a bank, one common rate sensitive vulnerability is the certificate of deposit. And another is maybe a money market mutual fund account. So when the interest rate rises, the bank has to pay more interest on these liabilities. But on the other hand, they also have a fixed big vulnerability that not even knows features from a Christmas account. So, for example, I have, goodness me, I have a savings account that only pays at an interest rate of 2%. Regardless of what the interest rate is now prevailing in the national economy. People ignore the kind of fixed rate vulnerability and concentrate instead in a discussion of managing interest rate risk. People concentrate on rate sensitive vulnerabilities and assets. So, can you think of an asset of the bank that is sensitive to the interest rate? Any examples that you can think of? For example, you may have a variable rate mortgage on a home. The interest to pay the bank for the mortgage may vary over time. Sometimes the interest rate is 5%, sometimes it's 7%. Who knows? Variable rate mortgages are extremely popular in part because the bank offers incentives. That perhaps cutting down on the initial pay down. So that is just to just several big asset products that they still worry about. Okay, so in this case, there are vulnerabilities sensitive to the interest rate that exceed assets. Overall, we have 30 million pegging worth of vulnerabilities that outstrip assets given sensitivity to the interest rate. So there was the gap, the difference between vulnerabilities and assets. 130, 100. So now suppose that the interest rate rises by 1%. Then on the net amount of vulnerabilities, $30 million, people have to pay at the bank interest that has increased by 1%. So the loss of profits to the bank that are due to having more liabilities than assets is 0.3%. Okay, here's a puzzle for you. So one foot of extra pivot. What now is the gap in this case? Well, let's see. Vulnerabilities. Or 150. And assets of 230. So the gap now, the difference between liabilities, correctly spelled, minus assets, both instruments are sensitive to the interest rate. This 150. Minus 200, a depth of minus 50. Now, note that this would be interpreted as a net gain, but because we have defined the depth as vulnerabilities minus assets, and that gain in the case is a negative number. So now, if the interest rate rises by 1%, then the value of a big sensitive product go rise by 1% times 50 or 0.5%. So you can see that a commercial bank may work hard to attract more assets than it has some vulnerabilities that are sensitive to the interest rate.